Welcome to the Manage Impact Development Training for Operations Manager. My name is Brian Wren, and I'm a knowledge engineer with Microsoft, focusing on System Center and cloud technologies. This module is titled Understanding Classes. This is the first module in a set where we're going to cover everything about classes. We'll start in this module with the basic concepts, and then the next module we'll talk about how we define the relationships between classes. Then we'll talk about how we design a set of classes for a particular application, and we'll do exactly that for our sample app. Then finally, we'll actually jump into Visual Studio and build the classes and relationships that we defined. Of course, the training will then move on beyond that on how we discover those classes and, of course, how we monitor them. A class represents a particular type of object. That object could be a computer, some component of an application, the application itself, a network device. Basically, anything that you want to monitor is represented by a particular class. The individual items represented by a class are called instances. For example, we have a class for a SQL database. Each database that we discover is an instance of the SQL database class. All instances of a class share the same set of properties, although they may have different values for those properties. Now, each class has another class that it's based on, and when you define a class, you need to decide what its base class will be. A class inherits all the properties, relationships, and monitoring from its base class. And of course, we'll give some examples of common base classes that we use and what the implication of each of those base classes are. So let's illustrate this concept of a base class and inheritance with a specific example. This diagram shows the tree for the SQL database class that I mentioned earlier. At the very root of the tree, we have the entity class, which every single other class inherits from. All Manage Impacts, every single class, eventually will trace back to entity. It's defined in the system library, and it's the only class that doesn't have a base class. If you're using Opsman 2012, the entity class has been renamed to object, so you may see that name instead of entity. Same class, different name. Logical entity inherits from entity. In other words, the logical entity class defines entity as its base class. Then, as you can see, we have an application component, then database, and then SQL database. Now, if we add an Oracle Management Pack, then we would probably expect an Oracle database class to be based on the database class next to SQL database. Following our SQL example, though, we finally come to the SQL 2008 and 2012 database classes. Of course, there are also classes for earlier versions of SQL, such as 2005. But for simplicity, we're just showing these two here. Now, these are shown in a different color because they're concrete classes, while the others are abstract. We'll cover that concept in a couple of slides. The reason that we have a different class for the different versions is so we can manage them separately. Each version of SQL has its own MP. The SQL database class is defined in a common SQL library MP that the others reference. And the different version MPs define a unique class. This allows them to target unique monitoring each one and include them in their own views. Because they're both inheriting from the same SQL database class, though, we can target a state view at that class that will include databases from all versions of SQL. So you can see how we define different classes for uniqueness that we require, but we can use a common base class to tie together those unique classes. So now let's have a look at properties. If you go to the System Library MP and look at the definition of the entity class, you'll see it has a single property, which is display name. Since logical entity inherits from entity, it inherits that property. Same for application component, logical entity, and so on up the tree to all other classes. Since every single class eventually inherits from entity, every single class has that display name property. Now, if you look at the definition of the other classes, they don't have any additional properties, so they just have that one display name, until you get to SQL database, which actually has several additional properties. I just threw a couple of them in here. There are actually about a dozen, but just for the sake of display, I just throw a couple. Because SQL 2008 and 2012 inherit from SQL database, they inherit those properties. So hopefully that illustrates that basic concept. In a moment, I'll actually jump into a demo and show exactly this example. We'll look at the actual management packs themselves and look in the ops console to look at how this is actually implemented. Before we do that, though, let's cover one other concept fairly quickly, which is key properties. When you define a property, you need to specify whether it's a key property or not. Most properties, the vast majority of properties, will not be a key. A key property uniquely identifies each instance of a class. Following our database example, the key property is database name. What that means is that no two databases can have the same name on the same SQL instance. All the other properties can have the same value, and we don't specify them as a key. But two databases aren't allowed to have the same name, so we define them as a key. And the reason for this is that Operations Manager needs to have some way to uniquely identify every single object that it manages. Now, a key property is only required if you have a class with multiple instances on an agent. For any class that can only have one instance, for instance, a service, for example, would only have one instance on a particular agent, so it doesn't need a key property. Even though we might have a property called service name, we wouldn't give it a key. And again, as we start to get further into more specific examples, we'll illustrate this. Now, this whole concept of key properties actually gets a little bit more complicated because we have to worry about hosting relationships and parent classes, but we'll need to get into relationships to really tell the rest of that story. So we'll go just this far now, and then the next module will actually fill in the rest of the detail. So let's illustrate these concepts, and let's actually look at the SQL database class that I showed on that slide. So I have open here the SQL 2012 Discovery MP, and this is where it defines the SQL 2012 classes. And you can see here is the 2012 database, which is the class that I showed earlier. There's an exact equivalent in the SQL 2008 MP. And you can see that there are no properties defined on this class. But we can look over here and see that its base class is SQL Server Database. And we won't worry too much about all the syntax and XML structure at this point. We'll define that a lot more when we actually start to create our own classes. This SQL right here in the base class name actually tells us that this is in another management pack. And again, we'll get into references and aliases and the whole bit when we actually start doing this ourselves. But we can go over and look at this SQL Server Database class, which is in the SQL Server Library. This is it defined here. And of course, that's where we see all of the different properties associated with the database, where they're all defined. And so the 2012 database class, when it inherits from this one, inherits all of those properties. Exactly the same thing with 2008. And if you go back to the older MPs, 2005, and certainly moving forward into subsequent SQL MPs, can share this base class and inherit its properties. They have the option to add more properties if they need to, if there's some uniqueness that comes along in that particular version. But if you look at the properties here, we don't necessarily need to go through and define each one. We can see, as we talked about with key properties, that database name has its key set to true. All the others have their key set to false, and that's because we can't have two databases with the same name on the same agent. And again, we'll get more into that concept when we talk about hosting relationships in the next module, because it gets a little bit more complex than that. But if we look at the SQL database base class, we can see that it is in fact system database. And this alias tells us that it's in the system library. So let's go have a look at the system library. We can see here is system database. Again, no properties defined here, as we mentioned before. We can see that its base is system application component, which is defined right there. Its base is logical entity, which is defined here. And finally, its base is system entity, which is this class right here. And you can see that it's the only class in all management packs that has no base class. All others have a base class, and all others, if you trace them back through their base classes like we just did, you're always going to end up at system entity. And as I mentioned before, you see here display name is its only property. Now, in this case, I'm showing the Opsman 2007 R2 system library. If you open this up, if you do this yourself and look at the 2012 system library, you're going to see a little bit more complexity, some of the classes that are added to this structure. Really nothing at all as MP authors that we need to worry about once you start using base classes that are going to be common, that we'll talk about in a bit. It really makes no difference whatsoever what's down there underneath the covers. So just want to note that in case you're looking at 2012, the system library in 2012, and you see some differences there. So let's illustrate these concepts and look at how they're actually implemented in the operations console. And this should really drive everything home and show the actual end result of these class definitions. So I'm using here the discovered inventory view. And if you're not familiar with this, it's kind of a catch-all view that lets you select any class from all the MPs in your environment, your management group, and look at all the instances of that class. So we're going to start with SQL Server 2012 database, which is what we were looking at on that previous slide. And what we're looking at here is a list of all of the SQL 2012 databases that we've discovered in my management group. These are what we would, to use the correct terminology, is these are all instances of the SQL 2012 database class. Now if I select any one of these, we're going to see down below all of the properties that we've collected for this particular instance. And remember, we saw where those were defined on the SQL database class in the MP. And if I select any others, I'm going to see the exact same list of properties, although the values of those properties change. Because remember, all instances of a class share the same sets, the same set of properties. So now let's take a step up and look at the SQL database class. Remember, this is the one that the 2012 database class is based on. Now here I'm looking at the exact same list. Now my particular environment here, I only have SQL 2012 installed. Probably illustrate the concept a little bit better if I also had some 2008 databases installed. If I did, this list would actually be longer, because any instance of a class is also an instance of its base class. So when I was looking at SQL 2012 database, I was looking at all the instances of SQL 2012 databases in the environment. When I'm looking at SQL database, I'm looking at all instances of all classes that inherit from this particular class. So if there were some 2008 databases that we had discovered, we'd see them on this list as well. But if I click on any of these instances, we're going to see the exact same properties we saw before. Remember, SQL database is where the properties are defined. Now, where things will start to get a little different is if we move up to the database class. Remember, this is the one that SQL database is based on. Now, I'm looking here at the exact same list, which again, shouldn't be surprising. Maybe if I had Oracle or something else in the environment, we'd see some other instances listed. But now, if I click on any of these instances, I see a much smaller set of properties. Because remember, if you think about it from the tree concept, database has no properties, and its only property that we should see is display name, which it got from that system entity. All of the database specific properties for SQL were defined on SQL database, which is further down the tree. So I'm going to step one more up here, and I'm going to go to application component. Now this actually is going to take probably a few seconds certainly to display, because what I'm looking at now actually happened fairly quick. This list is actually quite long, because what I'm looking at here are all instances of all classes inheriting from application component. Application component is a very common base class that we use, and we'll talk about that in a moment. And so that's what we're seeing here of all those discovered instances of those various classes. Not all that particularly useful for doing monitoring. Basically, we would expect all of the different MPs that are discovering these instances to have their own views and do their own monitoring. But in this case, I'm just using it here to really illustrate this whole concept of how the base classes work. And of course, I could go up to logical entity, and I could select entity here. I suggest you don't, because then I'm going to have to display literally every single discovered instance of every class in your environment, which obviously is going to take some overhead there. But hopefully this illustrates all of these concepts of base classes and inheritance. And now, so let's move on and talk about some more other details that we need to cover as far as classes are concerned. So hopefully that demo gives you some more context around classes and base classes. There are some more details that we need to cover though. Let's start with abstract classes. An abstract class is simply a class that has no instances. We use them exclusively for base classes. Most of the classes that you find in the libraries are going to be abstract. Because they have no instances, you won't have any discoveries for abstract classes, and if you try to discover an instance for one, you'll get an error. The reason we define classes as abstract is that we don't want an author to use them in the wrong way. Take the system database class we just saw. We want management packs to define a class for their specific database application, not use the generic one. We do want them to inherit from that one, though, so we can provide some commonality with other databases. By defining an abstract class, we enforce that behavior. I'm showing here another example of an abstract class from the IIS management pack. We have System Web and the IIS website classes defined as abstract, but then we have a couple of concrete classes, which is the name that we give to classes that do have instances for each version of IIS, and this is really the same strategy that I showed with SQL. The next concept to cover is singleton classes. Singletons also have no discovery because they will always have one and only one instance. That instance is created at the time the management pack is installed. Singletons are used for classes that will have only one instance throughout the entire management group. The most common example of singletons are groups. Every group is a singleton class. They're always going to exist, so we don't need a discovery, and we only want a single instance, so we define them as a singleton. The other common example of singletons is distributed applications. When you look at the distributed applications view in the operations console, you're actually looking at singleton classes. Groups are a little special though, so let's talk about them in some more detail. To be a little more specific, a group is a singleton class that has a containment relationship with its members. We don't know what a containment relationship is yet, but we'll learn about that in more detail in the next lesson. Now, groups are used for a few specific reasons, and you should already be familiar with those. We use them for overrides, to change monitoring details for a group of objects. We can use them to scope reports, to scope user roles, to define objects that a user has access to. And finally, we use them to define notifications. What we don't use groups for is a target for monitoring. We'll cover targeting later, but briefly, every workflow has a target which defines the class that it will operate against. Workflows are delivered to agents that have instances of the target class, and the workflow runs there. Singleton classes are unhosted, which means they're managed by the root management server in Operations Manager 2007 and by the All Management Servers pool in 2012. If you target a workflow at a group, it will run, but it's going to run back on a management server, which is probably not the behavior you're looking for. What it will not do is enumerate the members of the group and run against each one. That's typically the behavior that authors have in mind when they target a group, but simply put, that's not going to work. And again, we'll get more into targeting later on, and that concept should become very clear. Now that you have all these details on classes, how do we actually go about designing a set for our management pack? Like so many decisions in programming, there are no hard and fast rules to follow here, but we can at least provide some basic guidelines. Simply put, you're going to want a class for each logical component of the application that you want to monitor. That list is going to vary significantly for each application that you work with and depend on your particular monitoring requirements. For each class that you define, you want to think of what properties that you can collect that are relevant to monitoring for that class. Let's try to provide some better logic here. The general rule to go by is that if you aren't going to measure the health of a particular component, then don't create a class for it. But if you do want to provide unique health for an object, then you're going to need a class. So let's use our SQL example again. We could just create a class for the database engine and target all of our database monitoring there. If one database becomes unhealthy though, say it runs out of space or goes offline, we would show the database engine is unhealthy. We can include the database name and the resulting alert, but we couldn't distinguish between the health of different databases. So in that case, we want one class for the database engine and another class for the database so that we can discover each database individually and measure the health of each one. On the other hand, if you're working with a management pack and find you have no monitoring targeted a class that you defined, then you should question whether the class should exist at all. Similarly, if you have two classes that have almost identical monitoring, then consider consolidating them. Instead of two classes, maybe go with a single class, but then use a property to distinguish between different instances. For example, if you look at the MSMQ management pack, which is Microsoft message queuing, Queues can either be public or private, so you might consider creating an abstract class for a queue, and then a separate class based on that one for a public queue and a private queue. But the management pack doesn't define any unique monitoring for public and private queues, so instead it just has a property on the queue class that specifies whether the queue is public. It then has a separate group for public and private queues that's populated based on that property. The groups can then be used for views and reports. But in that management pack, there's simply no value in creating those additional classes. It just adds complexity to the management pack without really providing any additional value. Another thing to consider is how many instances you're going to discover for a particular class. Consider the DNS management pack. We might consider creating a class for a DNS record. We could collect properties for individual records and monitor the health of each one. But a typical environment is going to probably have thousands of DNS entries. Think of what a state view would look like for that in the operations console. The number of instances would just be too difficult to deal with, so it really doesn't make sense to do that. Instead, we have a class for a DNS zone, and we set the health and alerts for that zone based on the health of its contained entry. The last thing to think about is how many properties you're collecting. Keep in mind that we're only interested in properties that were used for monitoring. We use products like SCCM to do software inventory, so you don't want to collect every last little detail about a class. Start with the properties you're going to require for monitoring, and then potentially add more later as you find you need them. The last thing we want to cover is some detail on base classes. Every class that you create is going to have a base class, and the base class that you use is going to define how that class behaves. So what logic can you use to determine which base class you're going to use? The first thing to consider is what the class is going to inherit from its base. As I mentioned before, each class is going to inherit the properties of its parent. Now, most of the library base classes that you use aren't going to have any properties to inherit, but you might create an abstract of your own for classes that have similar properties, just like I showed in the SQL example. The class is also going to inherit the relationships of its base class. And we haven't talked about relationships yet, so this will make more sense in the next lesson. But understand for now that if your base class is hosted, then the class inheriting from it will be hosted by the same parent. So since a database class is hosted by a database engine, then any class inheriting from it will also be hosted by database engine. If your class shouldn't be hosted by database engine, then you would need to use a different base class. Again, in the next lesson, that concept will make a lot more sense. And finally, we're going to inherit any monitoring from our base class. So any monitors or rules that are targeted at a class will also run against any classes inheriting from them. So for example, I could target a monitor at the SQL database class that would then be inherited by each of the specific version database classes. That really isn't something that we do very often, but you absolutely could do it. The one example that you will see, though, are aggregate monitors. And they're a set that any ops manager user should be familiar with. Any monitor that you create is going to have to be placed underneath one of the aggregates: availability, performance, configuration, and security. And those aggregates are on every single class that you create. The reason for that is they are actually defined back on the entity class in the system library that we talked about earlier. So therefore, they are inherited by every single class below them. The next thing to consider is logical grouping of classes. You can use a base class to associate common classes with each other. Again, using the SQL example, we could create a view based on SQL database that would then include databases from all versions of SQL. This is because the management packs for the different SQL versions inherit it from that common base class in the library. This is a strategy that you can use in your management pack when you have classes that should be related this way. And we'll actually show an example of this when we create the management pack for our sample application. We also have to think about health rollup on our base classes. That's where the health of one class is dependent on the health of another. As we'll see in a later lesson, this is because of dependency monitors. And we're really still just talking about inheriting monitoring. But one of the big considerations that you're going to take into account when picking a library-based class is what health rollup you're going to inherit. Finally, we need to think about something that I call side effects. Operations manager will actually treat certain classes differently. For example, if you base your class on system service, it's going to be displayed in distributed applications in the Operations Console. If you use Instance Group or Computer Group, it will show up under the Groups workspace. There are other classes, though, where you might find that your class just doesn't work as expected. That's because these are special classes designed for specific purposes, and they aren't meant for you to use. Of course, the question is, how do you know which classes have side effects? Rather than answer that question, it's easiest to just give you a list of base classes from the libraries that you should use. This is certainly not an exhaustive list, and there are other base classes you'll use in certain circumstances. Network devices, for example, have particular base classes, and we'll identify those later when we talk about monitoring networks. For the bulk of management packs that you're going to create, though, you can typically get by sticking to this list. By using one of these base classes, you can be assured that your class is going to behave as expected. Now, we'll come back to this list at the end of the next lesson, because we need to understand hosting relationships to really understand the implications of each of these. But we can walk through it right now to give a first introduction. First, we have our computer roles, and we have one for Windows and one for Unix, depending on which platform that your application is running on. This typically represents a primary function of a server, database server, web server, domain controller, that sort of thing. We can have more than one on a particular computer, but we typically think of these as the primary roles that the server is performing. Now, this class is going to be hosted by Windows computer, Unix computer. Again, we're not entirely familiar with what that means yet, but for now, just think of it as the instances of that class will be managed on the computer that they're installed on. In the next lesson, we'll talk more about what that means. This also inherits an automatic health rollup to the computer. So what that means is that if an instance of your class goes to, say, a critical state, then the computer that it's hosted on is also going to show as critical. And we're also going to add a column into the computer state view for that particular class. And that's in the Operations Console that will be displayed. Now, the local application classes are functional equivalent, really, of the computer roles. Really operate the same in almost all respects, except we're not going to display them in the state view for the computer. In local application, typically, we are thinking about some service that's running on the computer or some component of the application, but not really its primary function. So there's really not a lot of difference between computer role and local application, and it's really up to the discretion of the author of which one they care to use. The application component classes we use to represent some component of the application. Now, these are unhosted. Again, we'll talk about what that means later. And you typically create your own hosting relationship for the application components. They're typically hosted by another class that's based on computer role local application. So an example of this is, I mentioned the message queue management pack earlier. And so in that MP, the MSMQ server is based on Windows computer role. The message queues themselves are based on application component. And so again, this is something we'll talk about more when we get into relationships and even further when we get into our sample application that we're going to design the MP for. Now, system application component, very similar, and also unhosted. These are ones that we often leave unhosted. You could create a hosting relationship for them, but we usually will use system application component for some other component of an application that maybe is not specifically installed on a server. Maybe it's kind of a more of a conceptual class that's created for. It's a little bit difficult to describe the circumstances where we use it, but again, it's something that'll become more clear as we move forward. We then come to our group classes, instance group and computer group. Now, the difference between those is instance group is going to contain instances, either a bunch of instances of one class or of different classes, but they contain actual objects, instances of other classes. Now, the computer group is similar, except it's only going to contain computer objects. And essentially what we're going to put in there are computers that have instances of a particular class installed in them. So for example, maybe we have an instance group that includes database engines. The computer group would hold the computers that those database engines are installed on. And so that way you could say, for instance, here's a state view of all of our SQL servers is what those are used for. Now, the group classes, it is listed there as a singleton. Technically, the base classes are not singletons. But the classes that we create based on them, we will define as singleton. Basically, the base class, if you recall when we talked about singletons, we said that there's one and only one instance of it. So for the base classes, we actually need multiple classes based on them, so they can't be installed as singleton. But know that typically all the classes we create based on those, we will define as singleton, which is why I listed there. Now, any of those classes will show up in the group list in the operations console and allow the user to interact with them, do edit for defining which objects will be contained in the groups. System group, very similar to the others. It won't, anything you base on it will not show up in the groups list, though. Also, we will typically create singletons based on this, but we usually use system group for health rollups. Little bit difficult to describe this at this point because we haven't gotten into dependency monitors and other things, but we'll actually show an example of this in our sample application, so it should make some more sense. And then finally, we have system service, which represents a distributed application. So if you're in the operations console and you create a new distributed application, use the distributed app designer, that's actually creating a new class based on system service. And we use this to represent an overall application. And again, this is something that we'll show on our sample application, but you might think of something like an Exchange environment, for example, and all of the Exchange servers and other components that make that up will roll up into one overall health state. And we can represent that overall application with a distributed app. Again, unhosted and singleton, and anything based on that will show up in that distributed application view in the operations console. So again, that's a very quick walkthrough. We really need to understand more about relationships to understand the full implications here. And it's something we'll absolutely get into in the next lesson on relationships, and we'll delve into in greater detail. And a lot of this should start to make a lot more sense when we design out our management pack for our sample application. That concludes this lesson. I invite you to move on to the next lesson in the training or refer to the other resources shown on this slide.